today. And there's just one thing that I want to say.
Welcome to Wesley United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Scott Grolke. Serving with me is Pastor Melly Momo. We are grateful to be here with you. This week, as we approach Thanksgiving, we hope and pray you'll find some reflective time for gratitude. Count your many blessings. This morning, we ask you to sign a connection card, and there's a prayer card in front of you as well, if you have someone you'd like to be praying for. If you did not get a consecration card this morning when you came in or in the mail, ask an usher. They can provide one for you for later in the consecration time. Is David Moon with us this morning? Don't see him. Tom, could you put up the step chart for us? This is an indicator of our movement in financial giving, but it's also an indicator of stepping up into discipleship in new levels of discipleship. Please be praying about this morning. Analyze where you're at in your giving and consider what God is calling you to do together. Pastor Melly, any other announcements you wanted to share?
No, this time.
God is good.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Wonderful.
Wesley, please stand and join us.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the thunder whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I we're all searching for answers only you provide, cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father to us.
Gather for Kylie's children's message.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. popcorn time.
What you got there?
Huh? Nothing. Nothing. Just don't know what you're talking about.
It smells super good.
It's the new fragrance I bought at Walmart. Not sponsored. Now today is Consecration Sunday, and I would like to give you a small insight on what that is. Now, have you ever heard of tax on popcorn? Well, this isn't a state or a federal tax, but this tax actually comes from your mom or your dad. You know, like when you have just fixed yourself a fresh bowl popcorn, and they come and take a handful of it from you just before you even had one little kernel. Well, that's what that would be. Now you might be thinking to yourself, Kylie, isn't that a form of stealing? Well, in a sense, yes, but at the same time, no, because you got the package of popcorn out of the cupboard. You opened it up, carefully put it into the microwave and cooked it. So technically, it's yours. But ask yourself who bought this bag of popcorn. I know for a fact that my mom and dad bought this popcorn. It was them who earned the money to buy it. So truly, the popcorn belongs to my mom and dad. And they are letting me enjoy it. This tax reminds us that everything we enjoy here on this earth is a blessing from God. We work hard to earn that money, but it is He who gives us that money. We are here to manage it, and He wants us to use our money, possessions, and our talents for Him. A big part of this is in our giving.
You
children know what tithing is? A tithe means a tenth, or 10% of what you have. In the Bible, we are taught to give 10% of our earnings to the Lord. So, for every dollar I make, I should give a dime back to the church. Now, most of us don't give close to that, and instead we keep it for ourselves. But remember, the popcorn. Just like the popcorn is not ours, the money is not really ours either, but rather it belongs to God. It's not too much to ask for us to give back that 10% to God. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing everyone together for Consecration Sunday. As Leviticus chapter 27, verse 30 reads, "A tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord." I pray I have brought the children one step closer to understanding giving back to the church. I hope this shows them the importance of their role in this church. In your name we pray. Amen. Now I hope you guys have an amazing Sunday and the rest of your week. And just as I've finished my popcorn, I've run out of time. And I hope to see you next time. Bye.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Kylie. Now is the time for us to pray. I have a few prayer requests. Pray for Ross and Julia. And we also pray for the family of Dixie, family of Dorothy Ribling as well. Let us go to the throne of God. Gracious and loving Father, we thank you this morning that you have allowed us to come together to worship you, to come together in your presence. We glorify your name and magnify, Lord, and thank you for the many blessings that you have given us and those to come. We give you praise. This morning, I pray that your spirit, Lord, will move upon each one of us gathered here and those watching from wherever they are. I ask that, Lord, you accept that our act of worship in the name of Jesus. I thank you for your love, for your faithfulness and grace. And thank you, Lord, for those who are celebrating healing this morning. Any kind of celebration, we give you praise for God. You have allowed that and you have blessed them as well. At the same time, we pray also for those who are not feeling well in this very place and those in the hospital, homes, nursing home. We extend the grace of healing upon them. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray for those who have lost loved ones that you comfort them during this time of loss. Encourage them, Lord, in your words, to go forward. We thank you, Lord, for the many people who are worshiping you this morning, wherever they are. Different churches, we ask that you bless them. And we also pray for those who don't have a place to worship, that you send them on our ways, Lord, especially those in Macomb area. We thank you, Lord, for your word that you have made available for us to help us in our walk. Thank you for calling us into your work with you. We ask that you continue blessing us in many ways. We pray for our country. We pray for the many other countries with unrest. We ask that your presence will be with them. Praying that you be with our leaders as your word encourages us to pray for them. Let your spirit be with them. Bless them with your wisdom so that they are able to lead this country according to your will. And bless our church, Lord. Help us to be at ministry with one another and with you. Bless us in all. Now I pray that you hear our prayers as we collectively lift our voices, saying the way your Son, Jesus Christ, continues to teach us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now I'll ask for the ushers to please come forward as we pray. God of grace, we ask that you bless what we have brought for you, that you multiply it for your work, you bless a source of provenance, and bless also those who don't have it today, that tomorrow they will be able to support your work. Lord, I give you praise and glory in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Psalm 100. These words are probably quite familiar to you. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us. We are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Please stand for the gospel reading. It's coming to us in from Mark 12, verse 38 to 44. As he taught, he said, beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation. He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in 2 small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. The word of God to the people of God. Please be seated.
If you would please stand and join us with a praise hymn.
Stay.
Let's offer prayer together. God, we do gather our thoughts and anticipate you will interpret for us the words we've heard, the gratitude, the giving in Christ. Amen. There's no hiding it. Jesus was a people watcher. The Gospels betray his preoccupation with watching people. This day he sits by the temple gate watching people enter and depart. He sees the scribes, the religious leaders, their tassels swaying in step with long robes and equally long faces. They move to their position in front where they might be seen by all and appreciated. And Jesus sees the other congregants as well. Each one passes by the 13 collection containers lined up along the temple wall, each one shaped like a horn, each container designated to a different project. One is for the food supply for the temple servants. Another is for the temple sacrifices. And one for the oil for the temple lamps. Jesus watches the people as they deposit their consecration gifts. The coins clank as they fall into the kettles. He sees the wealthy. The temple could barely exist without them. Their coins tumble down into the container like striking it rich in a slot machine. You hear them clanking down. And then he sees the elderly woman who shuffles forward, hoping to blend in with the stonework. She reaches into her bag and feels for the coins, the last ones. Carefully, she drops her two copper coins in a kettle. Jesus knows that some people have given 5% of their wealth, some 10%, some 20%. It seems like a lot. But some of them had a lot from which to give. Still, no one does what this woman has done. Two copper coins in the kettle is everything. It's 100%. It's almost as though she climbed up herself and put herself into the kettle. Take note sometime when you're reading this story in Mark's gospel, what takes place prior to this. Jesus has been very critical of religious leaders and wealthy leaders who will preserve at any cost their power, at any cost to the poor. Does our own culture not do the same thing? Do we depend unfairly on the giving of the lower and middle classes to keep the wealthy in positions of power? Jesus contrasts the powerful to the simple gift of this widow. He saw what she did. Through his eyes, you and I are forced to answer some difficult questions. What is God asking of me? Where are my two copper coins? Reminded me of the story of the woman who always passed out when things became too exciting for her. She just couldn't handle all the excitement. Her son protected her by going through the mail each day and sifting out things that might get her too excited or upset her. And one day she received a letter in the mail. It indicated that As her son read the note, it indicated that his mother had inherited several million dollars from a distant relative. He knew that this news would make his mother pass out, so he called in the minister, and together they talked about the letter. He briefed the minister on the details, and so slowly they explained the news to this woman of her new fortune. She handled it well until the minister asked her what her next step was going to be. She said she was going to give half of it to the church, and the minister passed out. And we wonder, what is God asking of me? Where are my two copper coins? In the last few weeks, we've heard from David Eck, John Corson, Marilyn Pastorelli, who've spoken of good stewardship, giving their own gifts. They shared their perspectives about giving, its impact on other people, and its impact on themselves. When you step up to giving, you're stepping up to a new level of discipleship. Remember the chart. Some of us step up to 1%. 1% of our income. Some to 2%, some to 5%, others to 10% or more. The writer David McKenna defines stewardship for us. He said, giving is measured not by its count, but by its cost. Not by its amount, but by its proportion. Not by how much is given, but by the spirit in which it is given. The step-up chart helps us determine not just a next level of giving, but really it's a next level of discipleship, because without discipleship, the giving means nothing. Like the woman with two coins, we wonder, what is God asking of me? Where are my two copper coins, and what do they represent? How do I step up to the next level? Marsha Brown wrote Stone Soup. It's the story of a group of hungry soldiers who came into a village looking for food. The villagers were afraid to share with them at first. The soldiers filled a huge kettle with water and put a large stone in it and put a fire on it and began to stir. One soldier tasted it and said it was delicious, but it just needed a little cabbage. So one villager said, well, I can provide a cabbage for you. Item by item, the soldiers told the curious villagers what would be needed for the soup. A little carrot, a little celery, some turnips, potatoes, onions, salt, a little parsley. One by one, the items were brought, and finally, the soldiers announced that a piece of meat would complete the soup, and one family was gracious to provide a piece of meat. And the soup was exquisite. The villagers overcame their fear by investing what they had for the benefit of all. We wonder, what is God asking of me? What and where are my two copper coins? How do I step up to the next level? What can I provide for the benefit of all? For me, it goes back to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, where Jesus said these words. This was his inaugural sermon. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim this the year of God's favor, God's grace." That's our mission. To bring good news to those impoverished of soul. To proclaim freedom to all held captive by personal behaviors or corporate oppression. To proclaim recovery of sight for all who wear blinders. To proclaim this as the year of God's jubilee, the time of release, the moment of grace. A As part of that mission, Jesus was watching people that day, and the widow who gave her all. And then Jesus became the widow giving all. For this passage ends Jesus' public ministry in the Gospel of Mark. Soon he will step up Calvary's mountain, consecrate his life, and give his all. Himself. So we do know. We do know what God is asking of us. We do know where to find our two copper coins and how to step up to the next level. We do know how we can provide a benefit for all. Before we conclude today's service, allow me to say thank you, because it's a season. It's a season for saying thank you. Thank you to Pastor Melly, who shares with me in this ministry. Thank you to the rest of the staff, some of them watching, worshiping with us on YouTube, who continually adapt to what it is to make disciples in this very strange time. Thank you to the choirs, musicians, directors who inspire us. Thank you to the video audio technicians upstairs who keep things running smoothly, Tom. Thank you for your team. Thank you to the missions team and social concerns team for those collecting the Thanksgiving baskets for the people in the community. Collections for Cunningham for all of our children's missions in the conference. Thank you to all of our committees and teams who carry out the mission, the ministry of Wesley Church. Thank you to committee members who are completing their 3-year term. I hope it didn't feel like a sentence. And for those just beginning, because it won't be a sentence, thank you to those worshiping in person with us today. Thank you for those worshiping with us on YouTube and Facebook. Now, our service will not end in the usual manner. It will end with soft music, but without hymn or choir, without liturgy or benediction. It will end with you. You end this one. You and I together will end when we complete our consecration pledge cards for 2022 and place them in the basket, and then depart from this worship space and time as you are ready. I close with a prayer. God of creation, we close our time with gratitude to you for the earth that has received our plantings, for the sun and rain that have brought them to full bounty. Lord, we're grateful for the people who reap the harvest and turn it into food for our bodies, minds, and spirits. Today we bring our gratitude and leave behind our commitment for the new year. We entrust our gifts to you. We go forward, believing that this consecration moment will help us grow forward in faith through Christ our Savior. Amen.